Hello everyone, I am Ankit and I have spent past 5 years in the industry across multiple roles with the sole core focus of fetching insights from the data faster. So I started off as a big data scientist where I deployed analytical models on some of the biggest databases that are available like Teradata and Netezza. And right now I'm working on deploying analytics at the edge on IoT devices. And so today's talk is about real world Numba. So in this talk, we'll be discussing about some real world applications of Numba. And I will show you how it offers one of the path of least resistance. So you might be wondering, what is the path of least resistance? So basically it is simply the path which is most traveled. So it requires the least effort, especially when it comes to open source software. We tend to follow a path which other people are using because it guarantees us more success. So I'll be talking about this path. And in respect to Python, so when it comes to Python, we all, when we run a Python code, deep down we all have this wish that I wish if my code was a bit faster. So each one of us, we all have this wish, and there is the chief question is there a way to speed up my code without making a lot of effort? So the least amount of effort goes into making the changes to make your code faster. So is there a way? And to show you this path, I will take you on a journey. Basically, it all started in 2010 when I was working in a project at my college at IIT Kanpur. And basically, it all started there when I came across Python for the first time. So we all spend a lot of time in our schools learning Java, C++, and it was in college when I first came across Python. And that was the first instance when I came to know that, okay, you can build applications using Python, full-fledged desktop applications. And it was way back in 2010, I made this FragGen project. You can see a lot of colorful buttons, so don't judge me on that, because there was no material design concepts back then. And basically it showed my enthusiasm. So all I wanted to do was, one of the subset was to generate a Mandelbrot set. So it's a 800x600 Mandelbrot set. And it took around 30 seconds to generate it. So basically there's a equation that you need to compute for each and every pixel. And you can basically plot the color plots, and it took around 30 seconds to do that. So I was happy with that because I had all the time on this world, but my project supervisor, he told me to focus on speeding up this process and looking for alternatives to speed up this generation. So there were options like Cython, boost.python at that time, but just like learning Python is quite easy, but speeding up Python was not that easy at that time. So the path of least resistance I found that time was the project called Psycho. It is dead now, but all I need to do was write import Psycho at the top of my project, run psycho.full, and that's it. So I brought down the speed to around 10 seconds. So it was 1/3, and I was happy with that. Then I further brought it down to 1 second by just reducing the size of the image. So I was fine with it because I had a lot of modules that I needed to cover, like WX Python and VPython, and a lot to explore. So I did not look further into this speeding up of Python. So present day. So we all are familiar with the Python 2 sunset right now. And just when I heard about this Python 2 sunset, I went on a frenzy of porting all my past codes into Python 3. And I came across, again, I rediscovered this old project, which was built on Python 2.5. So came across this project and I thought that, okay, coming to this, coming a decade later, how can I speed it up? What are the methods available to me? So this map shows, basically, this Gantt chart shows the timeline. I call it the two decades of timeline of basically need for speed. So this lists all the projects, Python projects that have come in the past two decades, the projects which still continue and the projects which gained traction, gained a lot of popularity, but now have disappeared. And the first one was Boost C++ libraries. It was a pure C++ library. So then came Pyrex. So Pyrex died down, but basically Cython, the Cython that we know today was actually a fork of Pyrex. So it still lives. Then Shedskin, it was a famous Google project that they started, but it also faded around 2013. Psycho, as I told you, was dead around 2012, but it was a spiritual successor of, basically, predecessor of PyPy. And then we had some other projects like Unlaid and Swallow, then Piston, Pigeon. These were also backed by some big companies, which have also shifted their focus away from speeding up Python. And around 2012, basically, Nuitka, Numba, and Python, these are the three projects we started, with Numba being started by the creator of NumPy. So these still live on. So you can see this is an overall timeline. And to tell you more about Numba, I will tell you how it is different from the other projects which are still alive. So basically, there are a lot of trade-offs involved in this whole process of speeding up the code. So Numba is not a replacement. Numba is not a replacement Python interpreter like PyPy. So PyPy has a whole different implementation. It has separate modules to run NumPy and stuff. So it is not a replacement interpreter to a C Python. Also, it does not translate Python code to C or C++, like Cython, Python, and Nuitka does. So it is also not a translator. So I'm not saying that these approaches are bad. It's just that it is not that easy to implement your code. So coming to Numba. So Numba basically is derived from NumPy plus Mamba. So Mamba is basically one of the fastest snakes on Earth. So they combined it and made Numba. And it is an open source JIT compiler, as you can see, which translate a subset of Python and NumPy codes into fast machine code. So it takes the function, it takes the argument. The function arguments are basically, it infers the type of the arguments, and then it converts, it performs a bytecode analysis of the function. Then it creates a Numba intermediate representation. And then it rewrites the intermediate representation, and basically, finally, it converts into a machine code. So this is how the entire workflow looks like. But if you go deeper, you need to know this. But right now, what you can do is basically, I'll show you how simple it is to actually apply it in our code. So coming to the first case, which is, again, close to my heart, it is generating the Mandelbrot set. So you can see this is a pure Python code. So what it does is basically you have a color palette that you can see right now since the plot is colorful, and you have pixels basically for each and every length cross breadth. So you have pixels, and then there are two for loops. Each basically the list. It's a list of tuples. So each value pixel value is denoted by a RBG value. And you assign a initialize a pixel value for a particular point on the complex plane. And you can see there's a complex data type that I have used to create a complex number representing a pixel. And then you again perform an iteration to find out whether or not that basically complex number has jumped basically its absolute value greater than a threshold. And then you plot it according to the color palette. So at what iteration it jumped. So this is a pure Python code using the basic data structures which are available in Python, list, tuple, complex. So how can you speed it up using Numba? All you need to do is just do import from Numba, import ngit, add a ngit decorator, and it will automatically convert. At the runtime, it will automatically compile your code into machine code, and you will get a speed which in my case was around 32x. So you can see you achieve this speed without applying a lot of effort. And basically the ngit decorator is nothing but a JIT decorator with with the attribute no Python is equal to true. So according to this, basically what happens is you do not want any involvement of the Python interpreter. That's why you do no Python equal to true, and you can only achieve good performance if you use this. So that's why by default try to use @ng decorator, and you have other function arguments like parallel, so it will automatically based on your system convert the code, parallelize the code execution. You can also include a fast math argument which will actually skip some checks for mathematical calculations and speed up your code. And you can do cache equal to true. So what it will do, it will save your compiled code on disk so that you can use it later. So you will save that compilation time, which is not that much, still you will save that time. And you also have an alternative to compile ahead of time. So there is also an alternative, but it is a different process. So coming to the second case, basically, which is again, which is a scientific computing problem, which is solving a diffusion equation. So in this, basically, you solve the diffusion equation, which is given by which is transient in time, and and you have to solve the temperature field in space, and you apply finite difference methods to compute it, which is central difference method for space and forward difference for time. So you have you have a rectangular geometry. You initialize some boundary conditions, and then with time you try to solve it. So the code, so the pure Python code which uses list, it looks like this. So you have two for loops. Inside that you compute basically temperature field for x across x and temperature field across y, and then basically the gradients, and then you basically compute the final temperature for that particular time. So it is purely mathematical computation, and suppose it takes speed x. Basically I went to a conference and I met someone who said, why don't you apply NumPy? It is fast. So what I did was basically I used NumPy. What I did, I kept the structure, core structure same, which was the two for loops. And just replace the list of list as a NumPy array, and it deteriorated my speed. Now my speed was 0.32 times of x. So it deteriorated my speed, and I was like, why am I using NumPy? So I reached out to the person again and said that, okay, please help me out. It is, the code performance has deteriorated. He said, you have to use NumPy in a particular way to get the optimal performance. Just use this vector implementation and basically you can speed up your process. So he sent me the code, I ran it. My speed was boosted by 55 times. I was quite happy that, okay, yeah, it worked. But you can see the whole structure of my code has now changed. It is not that intuitive to understand what is happening, all the mathematics. It's not that intuitive anymore. It's just a single line which computes the entire domain. So I went to another conference. I met someone who said, okay, why don't you do a thing? You use Numba on top of NumPy. It will speed up your code performance even faster. I was quite happy. So I did from Numba import ngit. I added an ngit decorator. Now my speed deteriorated again. So again, I was confused that, okay, what should I do now? My speed has deteriorated. What I am doing wrong right over here? So I sent my code back to the guru. He did some modifications and sent me back the code. Looks familiar? Yeah. So it was the path that I initially started with, and I'm back to square one. All I had to do was just do from Numba import ngit, apply the decorator, and I could have maintained my code readability and have gained the performance boost of around 370 times. So you can see how intuitive Numba is in terms of for scientific computing and data processing. So even if you use NumPy arrays, you can basically incorporate Numba, you can unroll the for loops, and you can gain that kind of performance. So right now I will show you, so I'll just go a bit deeper and show you what's the difference between the two codes and why my performance deteriorated for the NumPy vectorization on Numba. So Numba also provides some command line utilities through which you can generate annotated HTML files, which will actually show you what is happening behind the scene. So this was the code which had arrow operation, and you can see it is calling some underlying implementations. Basically, since it is an arrow operation, now we have to call corresponding NumPy array operations in Numba, and so it has a lot of overhead. Whereas if I unroll the for loops, I'm having no overheads. It analyzes the code as a whole and converts into a machine into the machine code, which gives which removes that overhead and gives you that performance. So coming back, so coming back to the third case, which is artificial neural network. Through this case, I will show you actually, since we follow the class structure, we tend to create classes in Python. So how you can incorporate Numba inside your class. So suppose there is a class for a neuron, which has various attributes. Then you have some available methods, like initializing the weights, setting the weights, and all. So one such method, let's take one such method, which is called update weights. So it has a for loop, you do some certain computations. Now, suppose I want to speed it up using Numba, what will I do? So if I just want to speed up a particular method, I can create a static method and apply ngit on top of it. And basically it will compile only that method, which can be used efficiently in your class. But you also have an alternative, which is using JIT class. So in JIT class, what you can do, you have to specify the spec. Spec is nothing but the data types of the attributes that you initialize. So the attributes that we saw, class attributes. So spec basically, you have to tell, it does not do an automatic type inferencing. You have to tell him what are the attributes and what is the data type. And you have to add @JIT class spec decorator to that class. And it will compile the entire class as a Numba, basically JITed code. So when is Numba a good idea? So basically, Numba is a good idea when you have numerical algorithms that has a lot of for loops, and basically data is in form of NumPy arrays. It can be flat buffer data. Then you have small chunks of code. It can be a lot of different codes, but you have a handful chunks of well encapsulated codes that you can basically compile to machine code and speed up the process. And it can also be used in your data science pipeline. For example, suppose you want to use k-means for scikit-learn k-means. Now you can do the entire k-means clustering process, but what if you have come up with a new cluster index and you want to evaluate your clustering using that index? So if scikit-learn does not have that kind of provision of automatic calculation of like that particular index, you can implement your own index and the computation of your index part, and you can just do a Numba JIT, and it will compile into a JITed code, which will give you that kind of performance boost. So it fits well in your data science pipeline. And this can be well established by the fact that Dask and Rapid. So Dask is the one of the leading scalable platform for data analytics. It is Dask and Rapids. Rapids is for CUDA. So they both love Numba. They have well partnership with Numba. You can run your Numba codes on these platforms. Also, if you are running basically some form of computation on your IoT device, you can use, for example, in Raspberry Pi, you have Berryconda. You can use, install a Numba on Berryconda, and you can use it. The same Mandelbrot set that I generated earlier, I computed it on basically Raspberry Pi, and I got around 20x performance boost by using Numba on Berryconda. So you can definitely try that out if you are doing some sort of computation on IoT devices. And yeah, that's it. Any questions?
Hi.
Hi.
Thanks for the talk. And looks like a pretty powerful tool. One doubt I have is about the trace back, especially if you have machine learning computations or anything like that going on. So how does the Numba JIT affect the trace back?
So basically, are you referring to basically debugging a Numba JITed code?
Yes.
Yeah. So you can, definitely you can land on basically errors by using some complex data type which Numba does not understand. So Numba has, right now they have an experimental GDB which can be called inside Python. And you can also basically use external GDB toolkit which is available on the compiled Numba code. So right now the external support of GDB is there, and also an inbuilt support is being experimented upon. So they are working towards giving some useful tracebacks. Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Rohit. Actually, you mentioned about an example where you were using NumPy and then it got reduced, your speed got reduced, and then you use NumPy with normal for loops and it got increased to 320x.
Yes.
So, can we combine the power of, say, Numba with the NumPy arrays and then get more speed, maybe more than 320x?
So the issue was, actually the issue was not about arrays.
Mm-hmm.
So, what happened was that there were operators which we were working on the arrays. So, we had basically plus minus operators which were overloaded by NumPy for to perform array operations. Now Numba has an basically implementation for those NumPy array operations, and what it does is basically it pushes back everything to the NumPy compiled codes. So that's why the codes were isolated and you had that overhead. But if you use for loops, unroll everything and use for loops, the entire code will be analyzed by Numba and it will look it as a whole and try to basically parallelize certain processes and combine it, and that's why it gives you that boost when you unroll the for loops. And it's not that, for example, you can use NumPy sine or NumPy cos function. It also has corresponding functions over here. But just be careful that you compare the performance. There are times when NumPy performs better. There are times when NumPy jitted with Numba does not perform that better. So you need to do some performance analysis between those two and take a call. Yeah.
Hi. Yeah. Hey, so I saw in the examples you are only using pure Python functions. Does it also work with extended libraries or?
For example,
if I am using something which is backed by Boost Python, does it still work in that case?
So I was using pure Python just to show that what data types it supports basically.
Mm-hmm.
So right now as function arguments, it supports the primitive data types that is there in Python and also NumPy data types. Now if I put in some complex data type in the as function argument, it will not understand. So it was basically a subset of Python and NumPy. So it might not have support for some complex data type that you are using some other basically library. For example, if you are trying to put in a pandas data frame, it will not work. Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hi. The decorators that you just used a simple decorator on top of the function.
Yes.
I'm assuming that Numba will perform better, or it needs the data types to perform well. Is that correct?
The @NJIT decorator will automatically determine the types. For JIT class, you have to tell the types. But with NJIT, you are using spec. Yeah, you might get that for the first run, that compilation, you might get lesser overhead. But after that, it will infer the type and perform equally.
Say, I'm thinking of a very trivial example, okay? So
sure.
Let's say I have an adder function.
Yeah.
It takes two parameters, A and B. I return A plus B.
Yeah.
If I pass 1 and 2, it's going to return 3 in pure Python.
Yes.
If I pass string A and B, it'll return AB.
Yes.
So how does Numba help in?
So basically, when you will run it using Numba, so for example, if you are using arguments 1 and 2, for the first run, it will determine that the arguments are int, and it will compute accordingly and return the result. But if you are using string, again for the first run, it will calculate the data type and give you the corresponding result. Now for successive run, it will work for the same thing. But for each different data types, it will infer and give you a new result. Yeah.
Hi.
Yeah.
Recite. Hi. Really like the talk. Okay. Then I was actually planning of porting my code to Cython.
Okay.
Okay. So I am really glad I came across this tool.
Yes,
it seems to be really good, too good to be true kind of thing. But my question is like, what would be the other part of the other side of the story? Like, what are the trade-offs related to it? Is there any pre-processing delays?
So the more than pre-processing delays, that will be not that much of a trade-off. But since it supports a subset of Python and NumPy, you might come across some operation. Basically, for example, let's take for calculating a NumPy array mean. Okay, it might not support an axis which is different. So it might not support the full length of arguments which are there in actual NumPy documentation. So, but in Numba documentation, it will clearly tell you that what all subset it supports. So that you, while using the code, you will have to go through some of the tracebacks, and it will tell you that, okay, in the error messages, it clearly tells you what it supports and what it does not support. So once you are running the code, you will come across it. But definitely, if you have any issues, you can ping me on GitHub or Twitter. Yeah.
Yeah. Hello. Thanks. That was a great talk. So my doubt is, so you're talking about Numba's use case in NumPy and other in case of certain for loop situations. So how does it work well with pandas? Because in pandas, certain times certain operations in columns might not be vectorized. So you need certain operations for that.
I told before, so it will not work with panda data types. So okay. Yeah, it will not work with that. You have to get the data frames values, and that is a NumPy array. On that, you can do the computations.